So how are you?
I'm good, mate.
Is this your first trip to town, as it were, to showbiz land for this movie?
I think so.
Does it feel like getting worked over when you...
I think it is. I think for this movie it is, yeah.
There's too much love for you, is what the problem is.
Oh, no, I've just come off Mary Magdalene a week ago.
Oh, good Lord.
So I've been just in a crazy place.
So you have a whole other movie really in your head.
It's already shot.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because there was another, I guess, Denis Villeneuve also came to town last week coming off of Blade Runner. And it was like the idea that he was now talking about a movie that was seemed, you know, 2 years ago for him.
Yes.
Very hard for him to switch gears.
Yeah. Look, it's for me, it's lovely. It's lovely to be
it's off of that
on the other side of the shoot and, you know, just being able to celebrate this film. So
you start post in a week or two? Or
no, not till February.
Oh.
So I'm just going to take some time with the family and be here for Lion in January, and then I'll start up again.
So how long was that shoot?
43 days. Was the shooting, it was pretty quick.
And extremely religious, or?
Well, it's religious.
Well, I mean, is your take on it?
Uber? Well, I see it as a humanistic portrayal of the story, so it's very exciting.
A scary thing to get into? I mean, in America, we...
I'm not scared.
I mean, a lot of filmmakers, certainly in the US, this is like tough turf as far as they're concerned.
I don't see it that way. I mean, you know, of course it's, you know, it's tough terrain, but I don't know, I just thought the script was beautiful, I trusted it. It was something I wanted to be involved with.
So how did Lion come into your life in the first place?
It's all Ian Canning and Emile Sherman's fault. We were at Sundance with Top of the Lake, and they really wanted to do something with me, and they'd just come across an article about Saru's story, and when they read it, they just felt that I could be really right for it, and I very quickly went off and read it and totally fell in love with the story. So I said to the boys, well, if you can get the rights, let's do it. And so they did.
You did.
Like a dog to a bone, they went and and then we worked on that, on the film together.
So how significant was the Top of the Lake experience for you?
It was big for me because my father died of a brain tumor, which was really brutal. It was 8 months of just being with him, and I came out the end of that, and a film that I was developing at the time for 3 years fell over. So it was like a ground zero moment. And just in that vacuum, in that space that you end up in, Jane Campion rang me. And I said, oh, hello, Jane Campion. And she said, I really love your work, and I'm wondering if you'd like to work on some TV. We're shooting in New Zealand, and I don't know. So I read it, I loved it. So for me, it was like a big healing. It was like the whole family, we could move to New Zealand and live there for a while and do some really beautiful drama. And it was just, it was kind of very fateful, really. So it, personally and emotionally, it was fantastic for us. And then the project itself was so exciting. It was like doing a movie.
And it sounds like you did not know Jane before this.
Look, I'd never met her, but... like Greg, for example, who I grew up shooting with, I've known him for over 20 years. We did everything together, so his reel was my reel. A lot of it was my reel. And so he just shot Bright Star with Jane. So Jane must have been aware of my work,
right?
And worked with people. So our paths were very close to crossing many times.
So how did the journey to being a filmmaker start for you? Were you always going to be a filmmaker?
Was this... No, not at all. I was a fine artist and designer. I ended up in like a design school in Melbourne for 4 years. I loved image making, and then graphic design went into computers, and I couldn't stand it because I love the physicality of making stuff. So I got very frustrated with that, and then I just took a year off. I became a bit of a hippie and lived with this very famous crazy artist called Valley Myers. I lived with her in this valley on a farm in Italy, which was pretty wild. No hot water, electricity, and just kind of painted and lived a life.
Sounds like a Tilda Swinton movie.
It was great, and I was going to come back and be a painter. And so when I came back to Australia, all my friends who are in advertising said, oh, can you come and make this thing for us? And so I just kind of slipped into it a bit. Which was fine. It was fun. But then one day...
Why did they think of you? I mean...
Well, before I left, I was doing a lot of experimental animation with topography. Uh-huh. And nobody was really doing that much in Australia. And it was quite unique. And it came into fashion quite heavily. I don't know if you remember a company called Tomato back in London and Why Not Associates. It was in that kind of ilk of design. And I was kind of doing that, and advertising was ravenous for it. I said, okay. So I just started doing it, and people loved it. And then I'd get another script from the agencies, and slowly but surely they became more narrative driven scripts, less about the technique.
Right.
And then one day I was mucking around with something, and I was in the edit room, and I cut these two close-ups together, and I felt emotion. Huh. And I went, oh shit, that's exciting. And that's when I understood filmmaking. I mean, I love cinema. I've watched lots of movies, and I love cinema. I'd always go to the movies. 3 times a week I'd go to the movies. Mm-hmm. But I never thought of myself being a director. But then I just fell in love with the alchemy of emotion, let go of all this other arty shit, and just it was, for me, it was all about the performances after that.
Well, it sounds like you kind of got sucked in through advertising.
Yeah.
Advertising
world. Well, that was my world.
Did you push off of that as an artist? I mean,
I was always an artist. I think I was always an artist. But my upbringing and my avenues obviously led me in. My father was a graphic designer. So I kind of led my,
you had the genes for it.
Yeah, it was impossible not to be in there. But I think I was always a frustrated artist in the industry, definitely.
So this was another direction to go to get back to something more pure?
Well, that's why I wanted to paint, because I really felt very satisfied when I painted. But when I was mucking around with film and I felt emotion, it was as satisfying as painting. I felt like I was fully satisfied. It felt like I was using all of my skills in a way that was very exciting. And the form itself, I found the alchemy of it, I found really exciting.
So were you able to combine commerciality enough to get it paid for and do the work you wanted to do?
I became a very successful commercials director. Right. For 20 years, I've been directing commercials. And for me, they're like little mini movies.
So you felt that, you were fulfilled by that. It wasn't like just because you were selling something didn't mean that it wasn't art.
I didn't think
art.
There was another option. I just thought, this is what people want me to do, and I'll do it. And I just love doing it. And I tried to make it better each time. And when I started out, Jonathan Glazer was at the top of his game. And I thought, wow, I want to do ads like that. So I had these mentors that I was aiming for. So advertising could be really exciting. I never really thought I'd make movies until later.
So what changed it?
I don't know. There was a point in the commercials that people kept saying they're like little movies, and I got really, I loved actors, and the actors kept saying to me, you should be making movies. So it just became pretty obvious that I should, because when you're making commercials, you're so busy.
Right.
You don't have time to really reflect. So, and I felt ready. I felt, okay, I'm ready to go.
So was there a huge leap from, because the short form is, you're doing your much bigger budget with a much shorter period of time and still a pretty significant shoot a lot of the time, but it's a different animal than shooting a 90-minute or 120-minute thing. And how was that transition for you?
Look, there was just some very basic things that I didn't really understand, which was like, how does a form work over that period of time? And when do you use music? When don't you use music? How long should a scene be? So the whole rhythm of a longer piece was something I wasn't familiar with. I mean, I could totally nail an ad or a 90-second or a 2-minute commercial. I totally knew and instinctively how to do that, but I just wasn't used to something longer. So it was a little bit intimidating. The making of things, no problems. I had that down pat, but it was just how to handle the poetry of the form. That was something that excited me, but I wasn't used to it. I don't know, the first thing I did was a piece of TV, actually, way back when my daughter was born, so that would be 11 years ago now. So that was my first dipping my toes into drama, but it was fun, it was really good.
And then you just worked your way through it and
found peace with it? Maybe in the first piece of drama you make, there's a section that you love for a certain reason, and you go, wow, next thing I want to do, I want it to be more of that. And even on top of the lake, there were some scenes that I did where I was so inspired by the acting. I found the acting very brave, more so than other scenes. And I thought, I just want to do a whole movie full of that. That's what I aspire to, you know.
Right.
It's like, for instance, in Lion, the scene with Nicole Kidman and Sonny, with Saru, when she's talking about the vision and how she could have... I mean, it was a moment when I was filming her where I wasn't aware of where I was because the performance was so transcendent. And I just thought, if you can just fill a movie with that, you'll have a masterpiece, you know. So that's really inspiring and something that I aspire towards, definitely.
So is it your job to get that moment that's happening on the set into the camera, or is it Greg's job at that point? Because you've set the stage and it's happening, and then he has to capture what that is?
Well, look, I'm trying to understand what makes those scenes great. Like, why does that scene work better than another scene? And I think it can be all sorts of things. It can be my contribution. It can be the lighting. It can also be the script. And I mean, I think the script is very important. How you prepare the actor and really encourage them to be brave, to go in directions they ordinarily wouldn't go. Let them know not to make obvious choices, to find colour in their journey and make all the mistakes they want to make. So there's all of that. So every now and then, everything aligns. So the lens choice, the lighting, the location, everything just feels right and everyone flies, and that's when you get those scenes. Mm.
So your job with the actors is to make it safe for them to dig, to go to those places?
Yeah. I mean, the actors, I love my actors, and I love rehearsal periods. I don't rehearse the scenes. I basically, we look at the characters and look at what's the key relationships they have in the film, or what are the key emotional journeys they go on, and we kind of workshop around those themes.
Mm-hmm.
So building relationships is very important. Do all sorts of things with the actors. And then, yes, tactility, physical tactility is something that I love in cinema, which I think is non-existent in a lot of cinema.
Mm.
I think a lot of people are being very serious. I love the Cassavetian set. So I love play, I love a relaxed set. So I just try and create an environment whereby the actors can be really brave and free.
So in this movie, it certainly breaks structurally on some level from what the traditional expectations are. It's very effective, but it's different. It's unusual. Does the first section of the movie where you're dealing with, we have a five-year-old on set, and in real life, you're dealing with a five-year-old, do you operate the same? Is it the same experience as working with, adult actors and
It's. I mean, you know, there's positive and negatives. When you work with a child, there's something amazing about it as well. There's something untamed about it, and sometimes, you know, they experience something for the first time in front of your lens. So there's a lot of great stuff that can come with working with children, but it's hard. You know, so you just can't have that direct dialogue or a shortchange conversation and just get to something very quickly together. So you've constantly got to be on with that child and working very hard to create a way that he can find the scene that's real and present. And that's really tricky. So it was terrifying to think that he had to hold the movie for the first half. It was very sobering.
Well, I mean, obviously this kid is special and has a certain energy that really pops on the screen, but can you really get him to act, as it were? Or are you getting him to feel something that maybe isn't about the movie, but is what he's supposed to be feeling, and then figuring a way to manage all that together?
Well, I worked with this amazing acting coach called Miranda Harcourt from New Zealand. She's an absolute genius and very dear friend, and together we spoke about how we were going to prepare Sonny for the shoot, and there's a lot of things that we did very early on that were part of just laying down some seeds and some foundations from which we could work from. And one of the things that Miranda did, which was really interesting, she basically wrote down every verb for Saru through the whole script, And if you arranged all those verbs, I think there was like six things that he had to do. One was about, you know, the love of family, fear, trust. There's all these, you know, running, you know, there's all these certain things that he had to do. And when we cast Saru, we realized that four of those things he could already do in his natural state. And the other things we had to work on. This is before you get into the craft of actually staging and things like that. That's a different thing altogether. But the emotional, like he ticked a lot of the boxes himself. And we knew we had some really challenging areas to go to. So we focused on that more than the other things. So that was really interesting. And it kind of demystified the process and made it more manageable and you could focus your energy. So that was very helpful. We worked on his diet. We worked on how he was treated on set. No hero worshipping. Very sensible kind of stuff. But this is not a... he had to act, really, because the scenes were holding the story. The scenes had to guide the story. So, I don't know. None of us had really done it before, I don't think. So we were just...
almost nobody has.
No, that's right.
Pretty remarkable.
So we... what happened eventually is that he did start to act. He actually started to act, and it was quite remarkable.
And the visual of all of that, and the style of all of that, was that you did you see that instantly in your own in your mind? Was it part of the script? Was it because there's a very kind of spare, open, brown, you know, it's a very strong visual style through that entire section.
Yeah.
Evident to you immediately, or?
Well, I mean, what I did is I just went to the real life places and imagined my 5-year old there. And very quickly you start to see imagery. So, I mean, a lot of the imagery and the way that we're going to approach it was inspired by that and never allowing the audience to be ahead of Saru, always being with Saru. So, you know, when he comes into Calcutta, there's no wide shot going, we're in Calcutta.
Right.
We're just with him. And then we're in the sea of bodies and then he has to climb a pillar to give us a wide shot. So, yeah, all of that was carefully designed. Yeah, and the ochre, the warm colour was kind of a bit of a theme through the film because it relates to his hometown and essentially that's how he finds home in the end is through the colour of the landscape. So all of that was kind of part of it. But yeah.
And is that harder to shoot than Australia? And is it emotionally harder to shoot as a filmmaker? I mean, there was a great film that I love, this film, that Lars von Trier did with a filmmaker called The Five Obstructions about doing... he had made a short film. This guy is Swedish, I think. Had made a film in the 60s that was a short called A Perfect Man. And Lars's object in this thing was for him to remake the film five times with a set of different set of obstructions every time. And one of them was going to Calcutta. And the guy shot it in Calcutta, and Lars didn't like the result, and he said, you have to go back and reshoot it. And he said, no, I can't do it. I can't go back there. I can't be part of that again. It was too emotionally draining for him to do it.
It's brutal. Like, you've got to imagine that you're dealing with utter chaos. You're trying to get a very succinct performance in a war zone. You've got noise, sounds, pollution. Your health is about 70%. And it's just fucking madness everywhere you look. And you've got to somehow just shuttle that away, bring Sunny into your little bubble and just, I don't know, just imagine it's not there. It's absolutely exhausting. It's incredibly exhausting. It's not for the faint-hearted, that's for sure. So nothing was easy. It was just one foot in front of the other and every day was absolute tricky, really, really tricky.
And did you do that section first?
Yeah. Dev's first scene was when he meets his mother.
So you do the end of the movie, the very end of the movie, and that.
Yeah, he had to well, he had to shoot all the Indian stuff in India first up. It was for two reasons. One, I felt that the Australian story, if we started there, we wouldn't be able to bring anything we learned from India into that imagery. You know, we'd be very complacent with it because that's where we live and we're used to modern stories. So I just was hoping that if we shot India first, it may actually inform how we approach the Australian stuff. And especially when Saru starts to feel India coming back, I didn't want that just to be on a plot point. I wanted it to be maybe through the way Lucy is, like a playfulness, you know, in the street is almost like he's with his brother. And I wanted the camera to kind of bring back the language of Calcutta again after being in this kind of restrained Hobart. So it was all really exciting creative process for us to kind of engineer, you know, camera and locations and lighting and performance of characters to help bring about Saru's story.
So really, is it a relief to get to Nicole after all of that?
Yeah. Nicole's great. I mean, all the actors were great.
Well, she obviously, I mean, it's a big commitment to, you know, she took a relatively small role in this picture and clearly wanted to make this, you know, gave her all for it.
Oh, she's just, I just love her. She's just so brilliant and passionate, and she just was so engaged on this film. Anytime you wanted to speak to her, you could get to her. She was, worked very hard. She was prepared. She was at rehearsals. I mean, I couldn't fault her. Yeah, she's great. You know, and she's such a method actor as well.
Yeah.
Like, she's kind of brave and wild. I love it.
Well, I think people forget because, you know, she's a movie star. And yeah. People, like, get hung up on the movie star part and forget that she's really, in many ways, she likes to be a character actress.
No, like, more. I mean, when I don't kind of see her in that way.
Right.
I just see her. And when we get together, it's just so easy. You know, we just, like we are now, just hanging out. And it's just straightforward. And I love her. She's got a great laugh, great sense of humor, and straight shooter, and she's a very genuine person.
And how did Rooney get involved with all of this?
Well, that was an interesting one because we were pretty stuffed on Lucy. Like, we'd been to a few people, and it was getting turned down a lot. And then actually Harvey said, what about Rooney Mara? And we said, you know, in our wildest dreams, you know, but we also knew that she, on a list we had, she wasn't available, so it wasn't...
Right.
And we go, well, she's not available. And he goes, well, I think she is. So that was very exciting. And then I said, well, I need to speak to her to see if she... Because my rule was that anybody coming to this film really had to be passionate about it. You know what I mean? It wasn't about getting a name or anything for me. It was they had to be passionate, no matter who it was. So when I got on the phone with Rooney, she just absolutely adored the script and the way that she spoke about it. I mean... You can ask her about it, but yeah, she was so into it.
Well, the funny thing of the picture is for me, it's the most Rooney performance I've ever seen. I mean, she, unlike Nicole, where there's that, you know, the movie star element, Rooney always, there's always that seriousness and that edge in the characters she's offered, I guess, mostly.
Yep.
And in this, there's a softness to her that I think is much closer to the Rooney I've met off of sets.
Exactly.
That it was lovely to see, and it was like, oh yeah, okay, that's great.
No, it's absolutely, and you know, like Nicole Kidman plays lots of different roles as well. I mean, and Dev, I mean, in many ways, with all the characters, I took them somewhere they don't usually go to. I met a genuine person. Rooney was this genuinely beautiful person. She had lots of light and spontaneity, and when those dimples come out, it's magic. Mm-hmm. So I just thought she's a great human. She needs to be a part of this, and I just really encouraged to bring it out, you know?
So as a director, is it part of your, you know, your wish list or your wants or whatever to push, to find actors who you kind of feel like you can take somewhere else that they haven't been, or is that coincidence in this case?
I don't even know I do that. So I think it's coincidence.
Well, I think you did. I mean, I think Nicole's performance is different than any we've seen from her, really.
Yeah.
I mean, we've seen some great performances by her, but this is an interesting... And Dev is certainly pushing the envelope on his adulthood.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
So are...
Yeah, it's weird. Someone actually said that. You realize you've cast people to play the opposite of themselves. Or, you know, and I thought, no, I never really thought about that. But maybe it's just that I see a side of them that maybe other filmmakers haven't.
Yeah.
You know, so maybe it's just that I see something in them that I want to just focus on rather than the other things.
Well, I guess Dev hasn't really been offered roles that are this...
No, he just gets typecast. That dark place. And yeah. There was a Q&A last night and he says, I don't know how many films I've been at a computer, you know, in a white shirt. Mm-hmm. And I just find that kind of sad. And everyone loves his sense of humour, but there's more to Dev. And he knows there's more to himself, and he's just never had an opportunity where he can express that. And so it was great to get in the room with him and kind of internalize his performance, you know. So when the energy comes up in a scene, rather than throwing it away with a physical movement or a joke, I just said, just keep it, you know, just retain it. And when we were working on that, it was very exciting.
So do you know on set when you're getting when it's the magic thing is happening?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, of course.
Always?
Yeah.
So is that when you say moving on? Or?
Yeah, totally.
How many?
And they go, really? And I go, it was great. Yeah, but you sure? And I go, yeah, it's great.
Let's so you're a 2-3 take director?
Huh?
Are you a 2-3 take director?
Well, it depends on the actor. Rooney's, you know, mostly a one take. I'll do two because you just should.
Right.
Maybe you'll go a bit further. But everyone's different. Mm. But I do have a policy of no regrets. So if the actor just feels something not right in the guts, then I said, well, we should, I mean, I'm happy, but if you're feeling something in the guts, then yeah, you got to trust your instincts. So let's keep playing with the scene and see if we can get rid of that feeling. And that's kind of fun too.
And what is post like for you? Are you a person who's trying to find the movie or refine the movie in post, or is it already pretty well defined for you and you're putting together something you kind of know is there already?
Well, you know, I suppose for me, I had a feeling about what Lion should be. You know, I obviously had some very strong ideas visually and structurally, and made some very strong decisions in the rhymes, and, you know, so all of that worked very well. But I think then you have to then just fine tune it and find the alchemy of it. And so it's, I mean, it's a really exciting process. It wasn't like trying to find the movie. Mm-hmm. No, we did do a lot of work.
Do you cut while you're shooting, or do you wait till the end?
No, I can't do that.
So no assembly?
There's an assembly, and like someone's assembling Mary Magdalene now, but right. it's kind of...
But you're letting them assemble it after you finish shooting.
It's kind of meaningless in a sense, because I'm not there and my vision's not being represented, but it's also helpful for someone to do it who's outside of your vision. And, you know, I found the assembly that Alex did for Lion incredibly helpful, because some of it was really good and not the way I imagined. And also it just gave you a sense of the form, you know, the whole movie. And you go, wow, that whole second act's very slow. Or so you could just get a bit of a feel for it as a shape. So it was very helpful for me.
Are you such a stalwart pro after all the years of advertising that it feels, because a lot of people, like a lot of directors, freak out when they see the assembly. They're a little scared by it or whatever. It sounds like you like are right on it. You're like, you know, you kind of, okay, we can fix this, we can adjust that. It doesn't sound like it intimidates you at all.
Well, I know from the shoot whether I've got it.
Right.
You know, I know in my guts whether I've got the film. And, you know, maybe it might take a while to find it, you know, in the edit room. But, but you know if you've got a movie once you've shot it. So if the assembly doesn't show it, I'm not going to get too worried.
Right.
Because I haven't got in there yet.
And what is post like for, I mean, is it different because of your advertising experience?
I've spent a lot of time. Well, you know, I've got...
It's not a fast-cut movie. It's not like it's like chop, 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 chop this movie at all.
No.
Which is what we always assume is an advertising shtick. But that does not seem to be your shtick.
No, I mean, I think you've got to... I mean, you do learn a lot cutting drama. You know, you've got to be very efficient. And that's something you learn from commercials as well. Like, and very helpful. Like, you can suddenly take a big scene and just dive in the middle of it and truncate it in a way that's still cinematic.
Right.
It's just got half the shots. And so I think the advertising training is very good for that, in being clever about how to build a scene very quickly.
You show it to a lot of people not a lot of people, but do you show it often to kind of get a sense of an audience reaction, or do you wait?
Well, I showed maybe two people along the way, two very different people. Someone that is in line with my kind of style of filmmaking and someone that's the opposite along the way. And then obviously the producers see it quite a bit. And then when we all get very happy with it, yes, then we show a room full of people.
It sounds like these producers are extremely supportive.
Yeah, we have a great relationship. I have a great collaboration with them. And I'm very open to their ideas, and it's a very respectful relationship. Yeah, I love working with them.
So what's the feeling when you do show it to that audience for the first time? Is it scary, or are you listening for specific things? Or
look, it's always terrifying, because, you know, your heart's on your sleeve. You know, it's
You don't seem easily terrified. Maybe it's because you smile so easily, but
maybe.
I don't know.
I don't know. Been down a few rabbit holes. I don't know. Like, you, what can you do? How can you change that circumstance? End of the day, you do the best work you can and hope that it translates to the audience. But, you know, I mean, one of our screenings, I loved what we'd done, and, you know, a couple of people really cut it down hard, and that was brutal. Mm. It's not an easy thing.
Were they
hear.
Right?
Huh?
Were they right at all?
Maybe in part, maybe in not, you know. So, look, they're just all the realities of what we do. You know, we make things that go into a public eye, and every Tom, Dick and Harry has an opinion. And it's trying to decide how much of that you want to engage with or not.
So when was your first public screening? Was it Toronto or?
Yeah.
So was that intimidating, or were you already comfortable that you had made the film you were going
to
make?
No, I was really proud of the film, and I'd been to enough research screenings to know that we were fine. So I wasn't nervous in that way, but it was just nerve wracking anyway.
Right.
Because my mum was in the audience. And
and when they cheer at the end, was that satisfying or?
Yeah, hugely satisfying. It was great. I mean, brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Do people talk to you about the movie? I mean, I guess you've done some Q&As. Have you?
Yeah, look, it touches people in so many different ways, you know. You know, you meet people that have adopted children. You meet, you know, fractured families. You meet people that, I don't know, it just touches people in so many different ways, and they all come out of the woodwork. Yeah, they love talking about it. Yeah.
Are you ever taken by surprise, or are you kind of... know the route that you were on, or the...
You mean the making of the movie?
No, well, in terms of how people are reacting to it, do you kind of know what emotional territory you were staking out here? And...
Well, I was hoping that it would open people up and start a conversation and maybe make them pick up the phone and be reminded of what's important, because I think that's something we need in our lives. So it was definitely my intention to get people into that space. Definitely, because that's what the story did to me. Mm-hmm. So I was hoping that the film would do the same thing.
So in getting into Mary Magdalene, was it just like, do you put one aside and you're now living a different movie? Or is that, and was there something particular about Mary Magdalene that was a change or a extension of the work that you did here?
Well, look, at the end of the day, I could do a science fiction, a first century film or line, as long as it explores the human condition and it's an emotional film, then I'm into it. So Mary Magdalene is definitely that. So it's my territory.
It's all, as long as it's emotional, it's your territory.
Well, as long as it gets into the depths of human relationships, and you know, we kind of dig in there and explore some stuff, I'm excited.
And do you have expectations? The movie hasn't opened yet in America, at least. I don't know if it's opened anywhere else officially, but is there a... Do you, I mean, obviously you care how things go and how it does business, all that.
Yeah, I hope it has a life. Yeah.
Do you weigh the value of your experience or the having choice of having done this or whatever on any of those things, Academy and, you know, business and all that kind of stuff?
No, like, there's been a lot of articles saying that this is like an Oscar bait movie. Like, they kind of presume that we only made this to win an Oscar, and it's like, it's just absurd and offensive, because, this was just a little Australian movie that we were kind of nobody. I was a first-time director. I mean, there was no attention on us making this movie, and we just made it with complete passion. So the movie is what it is because of what we made with passion and honesty. So I totally resent all that crap. And the fact that it's getting attention, fantastic. Great. I mean, well done. Awesome. But it wasn't the reason why we made it.
It is a weird conjecture that people come up with, particularly with a film that...
Anyway.
We're in a... this season, so particularly, upsetting. Is loaded with not Oscar bait movies that are rising.
Yeah.
And yet people continue to have this kind of weird perception that you have to... Somehow you were chasing that. Everybody was chasing that from the beginning. But almost none of the movies really in the race.
Well, I just don't think like people can trust... That. I don't think people trust good stories. Yeah. You know, like, I don't think people can trust that this story was real, even. You know, but if they do their homework, and they'll realize that we've just honored a true story, so it's not an invented thing. And who wouldn't want to tell this story? Who wouldn't want to make this film? So I don't get it.
Well, the experience of feeling, I think, sometimes freaks out journalists.
Yeah, there's not a lot of there's not a lot of feeling in movies, and to this extent, I mean, this is unafraid in that department. So maybe for some people it's too much, but you know, there's some people out there that want that as well.
I think I think ultimately everybody in real life wants it. I mean, that's why we go to the movies, isn't it? To be thrilled or excited. Well,
that's what I think.
To feel.
Not the critics don't think that sometimes, but yeah. Absolutely. Well, that's why I want to go to a movie. I want to go to a movie and be moved and come out with questions. I want to be thinking about it for days afterwards.
Yeah. Yeah. That's how you know it's good.
Yeah.
If it's still with you a couple of days afterwards.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah, and that's what great cinema is. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it. It's lovely talking to you.
And to you.